For several days, the people of Fort Smith had been curious about the odd winter weather. The skies were filled with heavy clouds, the temperature was too warm and sultry for January. On that fateful January 11th day, the temperature had been up in the 70s. At midnight, it was 73 degrees as the bluish-green clouds grew heavier and the lightning increased. Though it was 10 p.m., J.J. O'Donnell, the U.S. Weather Bureau observer, was still awake in his office in the uppermost part of the main hotel, measuring the barometric pressure, the increasing wind, making precise notes on the lightning. His experience and training suggested nothing more than a bad thunderstorm was approaching from the west. He monitored weather reports from the Indian Territory via telegraph hookup. He noted a 10 p.m. tornado sighting in the air between Hartshorn and Alderson, Indian Territory, but by 11 p.m., he was in the process of closing his office for the night. As O'Donnell recorded a little after 11 p.m., a gurgling noise was heard, like water rushing out of a bottle, followed immediately by a rumbling, such as that made by a number of heavy carriages rolling rapidly over a cobblestone pavement. And finally, like a railroad train. About 2 seconds elapsed between the first roar and the rattling and the quivering of the office window by the wind and the terrific driving rain, which at once forced itself in between the frame and the sash at the top, the bottom, and the sides, and flooded the office. The Book of Means was laid aside and the observer went to the landing in the large skylight on the roof of the observatory, whence he saw the tornado cloud 450 feet distant to the southward, a twisted black mass of two clouds accompanied by lightning from the upper parts of the clouds. At 11:08 p.m. precisely, the Great Cyclone of 1898 jumped the Arkansas River and landed in the beautiful old National Cemetery, crumbling the rock fence surrounding it like cardboard, ripping up the century-old trees from the roots, tossing headstones in all directions, and making rubble of the caretaker's house. The big meat cotton yard on Rogers Avenue was next after the tornado made a hop over the twin courthouses on South 6th Street. The pressure exploded the rock house of Mrs. Mivelees of South 9th and Carnal. Then the twister came down in the vicinity of the 800 block of Garrison, moving east down the avenue. Mr. O'Donnell watched the tornado pass his skylight observatory, 54 feet off the ground, seeing mounds of debris churning in the air on either side of its path. In 6 seconds, the tornado was out of view, though it continued its destruction in the area of North 12th Street, destroying the houses of the late Judge Parker and his hangman, George Maladin. The funnel smashed First Baptist Church, then crossed Grand Avenue, knocking off the top 3 stories of the brand new high school building, moving on to obliterate the historic Rector House on North 41st before continuing out of the city limits. There followed a heavy rain with hail for 4 minutes, but by 11:40, there wasn't a cloud in the sky. The sleeping inhabitants of Fort Smith never knew what hit them. In the area on Garrison between North 11th and 12th, to your left stood the Smith-Davis building with shops below and sleeping rooms and apartments upstairs. The building was flattened and then caught fire, killing 13 people. Ed Farrell was found dead under the wreckage with his 2 children at his side. Lying buried a mere 5 feet from the raging fire which was consuming the ruins, the voice of Mary Melissa Kaufman Lefevre could be heard. During the 3 hours it took to dig her from under the wreckage, she calmly told searchers where to dig and the location of the bodies of her husband Millard and her 2 young sons, Charles and John. Miss Lefevre would linger until 1903, never recovering from her injuries. Adjusted for inflation, the 1898 tornado is ranked 21st on the list of most damaging U.S. tornadoes since 1890. Fort Smith wouldn't see this kind of widespread destruction again until April 21st, 1996.